Leia here from leiaforsci.com, and in this video, I'm going to show you how to solve for the molecular structure when you're given a molecular formula and an H-NMR graph. You can find this entire video series by visiting my website, leiaforsci.com/HNMR. The first thing to do when you're given the molecular formula is to figure out your index of hydrogen deficiency so that you know if to consider any pi bonds or rings. To do that, we'll use the equation CnH2n plus 2, which I teach in the index of hydrogen deficiency video link below. N represents the number of carbon atoms. In this case, we have 6. So if we set it up as 2n plus 2 to solve for hydrogen, we have 2 times 6 plus 2, where 2 times 6 is 12, plus 2 is equal to 14. If we have the maximum number of hydrogens, we know we have a fully saturated molecule with no pi bonds and no rings. But in this case, we only have 13 hydrogens. So what does that mean? It has to be an even number. Don't forget that halogens, because of how they bind to carbon, count just like hydrogen. So if we add up 13 hydrogen plus one hydrogen-like halogen, we actually have 14. 14 minus 14 is 0. That means we have no pi bonds and no rings on this molecule. This helps us when we look at the structure because we know we don't have to consider anything crazy. This also helps us with the oxygen because it immediately rules out anything with a carbonyl. Remember, a carbonyl is a carbon double bound to oxygen, which would require an index of hydrogen deficiency. Now that we have an idea for the molecule, let's take a look at the graph. I'm going to break this down and solve it the way I teach in my beginner NMR videos, which you can find linked below, or by going to my website, leiaforsci.com/NMR. I consider the right side of the graph, anything near zero, the boring region. This means that the carbons and hydrogens on the right are further away from the exciting groups like halogen and oxygen in our case. And the left is the exciting group. That means these two are likely sitting close to the oxygen and the chlorine. I drew the peaks in different colors so that we can refer to them by color and have a very clear idea of what we're looking at. Let's analyze them starting from the right, where we have three hydrogens. So three hydrogens is going to be the CH3 with the peak of a triplet. How do we know it's a triplet? We can count three distinct tops, right? So this is 3 points for a triplet. We'll use n minus 1 to find the number of neighbors. So 3 points minus 1 tells us that we have two neighbors nearby. This right here is a CH3 group. I'll draw the ghost atoms in gray so we know not to count them as part of our molecules. But if we can match up a ghost to another piece, we know that we have a puzzle coming together. For the green peak, we have 6 hydrogens. This has to be 2 carbons because one carbon can have a maximum of 4 bonds, but 6 hydrogens have to be sitting on 2 equivalent carbons, meaning there's some sort of symmetry there. And having a doublet, meaning 2 points, tells us that we have only one neighbor. 2 minus 1 is equal to 1. That means there's one neighbor for these two different CH3 groups, which means we have a CH3, another CH3, sitting next to a carbon that has one hydrogen, splitting them both. I want to jump over to the purple peak real quick, because this is a pattern that you have to learn to recognize. Anytime you have a 6-hydrogen doublet and a 1-hydrogen multiplet, which is this mess over here, you should recognize this as an isopropyl group. The purple group is 1 hydrogen. Specifically, we have a septet, meaning we have 7 points, but you'll often see this just called multiplet, because anything over 5 or 6 becomes too messy. So we recognize, oh yeah, it's got a whole lot of neighbors. In this case, septet is 7. 7 minus 1 is 6 neighbors. Well, what other 6 neighbors would it be if not for our 6-hydrogen, 2CH3 groups? So let's go ahead and put that right in here. No more ghost CH. That right there is an isopropyl group. So we have one piece of the molecule. Let's go back to the blue 2-hydrogen group. We have 2 hydrogens with a quintet. Notice we have 5 points. A quintet is 5 minus 1 tells us that we have 4 neighbors. And the 4 neighbors could be one of two things. I can have a CH2 group on either side, which adds up to 4. Or I can have a CH3 on one side and a CH on the other. In this case, we know it has to be a CH3 on one side and a CH on the other, because this is the only peak on this graph that has 2 hydrogens. We have no other CH2s visible because nothing else has 2 hydrogens. Last but not least, the brown group on the left is 1 hydrogen in a triplet. We've already said that a triplet is 3 minus 1 for 2 neighbors, and that means this CH has a CH2 nearby. Now, notice we haven't even considered the oxygen and the chlorine yet, and the reason for that is intentional. A lot of students will try to match everything up at the same time, but if you let the carbons themselves match up like puzzle pieces that click, then typically the rest of the groups will fall into place. And if not, you want to take extra steps to figure out where they go, but why waste the energy if you don't have to? Before we start putting everything together, let's make sure we accounted for all 6 carbon atoms. Sometimes you'll have, say, a carbonyl that doesn't have any hydrogen, and you have to remember to create another puzzle piece on the side to take into consideration. So what do we have? 1 carbon, 2 carbons, so that's 3, another carbon is 4, another is 5, another is 6. All of the carbons are accounted for. Now look at our ghost groups. For the ghost groups, are there any ghost groups that match up a group that we have? For example, we know we have a CH3. This is the only CH3. I don't even need to look at the shift to see if they match up. I have no other option. So that tells me that the blue CH2 has a red CH3 on the side. We accounted for this, let's cross it out, same here. And we also accounted for this in the isopropyl group. The only thing that's missing is the brown CH. Well, we know that we have to have another CH on the other side of the blue group, so let's go ahead and put that CH right there. And that's it. We practically have the entire molecule put together, where we have 2 portions of the molecule. One portion is an isopropyl group. The other one is a regular propyl group. Now what? This is where it gets exciting. We have 2 pieces. We want to see how they connect. We also know we're still missing an oxygen and a chlorine. If you count up the bonds that are here, you'll recognize that the brown CH can have 2 more bonds because it needs to have a total of 4. And the purple CH already having 3 bonds, 2 to the methyl groups and 1 to the purple hydrogen, can have just 1 more bond. I challenge you to figure out the rest of this without even looking at the graph. We know we have to have an oxygen somewhere. Well, this one's got to have the oxygen because it's got 2 things. So it's actually got to have the oxygen and the chlorine. And the only way to make this one molecule is to attach these 2 together. So without even looking at where the shifts are happening, we figured out the molecule, but I do want to take you back to the graph to prove it. How did we know that the oxygen was an ether rather than an alcohol? Simple. An alcohol is an OH, and that hydrogen would show up as a broad, short singlet on the graph. If you look at the graph, we don't have any singlets. That tells us we don't have any alcohols. We've already ruled out the possibility of a carbonyl when we found the index of hydrogen deficiency to be 0, leaving us an ether where an oxygen is bound to 2 other carbon atoms as our only option. We know that halogens are considered exciting. They're highly electronegative, and they tend to pull the nearby carbons and hydrogens towards the 4 range, a little bit higher, a little bit lower, depending on what else is going on and which halogen we have. We said that the brown CH is holding the chlorine. Well, guess what? The brown CH is the highest shifted group. It is the most exciting, and doesn't that make sense given that it's next to both chlorine and oxygen? And the purple CH is the second most exciting group. It's the second highest shifted, and doesn't that make sense if it's directly attached to the oxygen but not also holding a chlorine? So now that we've matched everything up and we have all our puzzle pieces together, the final step is to draw this into some sort of a coherent molecule, because right now it looks like a mess. I'll draw it out with all the atoms first, then we'll do it in line structure. So we have a CH3, bound to a CH2, bound to a CH that is also holding a chlorine. Then we have an oxygen bound to the purple CH, bound to two green CH3 groups. Inline structure that gives us 1, 2, 3 carbons, where the third carbon is holding a chlorine and bound to an oxygen. And attached to that, we have an isopropyl group. And there you have it. There's our molecule that came together by analyzing the pieces. If you found this video helpful, first, give this video a thumbs up and make sure you subscribe to my channel so that you don't miss out on any of the new videos to follow this semester. I work through even more complex spectroscopy problems in the organic chemistry study hall. Not just H-NMR, but multi-spec, where we're looking at CNH-NMR, IR, and mass spec. You can find information about the study hall link below or go on aleaforsci.com/join.